Hello, I'm Ray Raleigh. I teach at Peninsula College in a small town of about 20,000 people in Port Angeles, Washington. Welcome to my presentation. I suspect some of you will already be quite familiar with at least some of this material, while others may discover that most of it's new. I hope everyone takes away at least a small nugget of new information by the end of the presentation. Also, a few of these slides are duplicated in another presentation I give in this conference titled The Commodification and Democratization of Higher Ed. But the majority of the material is different and focuses on disruptive technologies, whereas the other presentation only briefly touches on emergent and disruptive technologies and assesses the technological change as well as social and economic changes to then consider the commodification of higher ed. I'm excited to have this opportunity to share information about emerging technologies that will and have impacted our lives and altered our lifestyles. As industries are transformed by new technologies, jobs are being created that demand new skills. Business processes are being reimagined, new styles of secure digital interactions are being created, and all of this will change the way the world works. I'll introduce several of these technologies, including blockchain, the Internet of Things or IoT, artificial or augmented intelligence, the cloud, quantum computing, and a brief overview of other disruptive emerging technologies. Let's start with an overview of some disruptive technologies we're fairly familiar with, and then review new technologies just breaking the surface or still on the horizon. A significant number of companies have been relying for several years now on these SMAC technologies, which include mobile, analytics, cloud, and social media. Building online social communities and networks using applications such as Google, Facebook, and LinkedIn provided these companies with mountains of data on individuals, their preferences, and their values. Analytics increased the efficiency of businesses' marketing dollars. Additionally, they could make more accurate decisions based on an abundance of data and thereby optimizing their products and services for each customer, increasingly customizing experiences. Mobile technologies allowed people to access their communities and networks anywhere. They also allowed businesses to expand into consumers' lives on a daily basis. Although this functionality was only made possible by the cloud, where information on everything everyone does online is stored, all other information technologies are dependent on people storing their information on the cloud. All of these technologies combined allow businesses to understand consumers and partners at deeper levels. The next set of technologies companies will need to master are described as dark technologies. The D in the acronym stands for Distributed Ledger, or as most of you know it, the blockchain. The A stands for artificial intelligence. R is for extended reality, including virtual reality, but we already experience this in many forms, including when we use GPS. Finally, the Q is quantum computing. The research shows that 89% of businesses are already experimenting with one or more dark technology. These technologies are the next phase for businesses to deploy to remain competitive in their industries. The distributed ledger or blockchain technology eliminates the middlemen, such as realtors and title companies, lawyers, and any other type of brokers, any person or organization that is in between the seller and the buyer in a contractual activity. AI or artificial intelligence will increasingly automate business processes. It'll provide access to data and data analytics, which will become critical for businesses to use to remain competitive. And AI will give consumers even more access to services from anywhere and any device. Reality will become both more virtual and augmented. We experience augmented reality when we look at electronic maps with locations overlaid onto the physical, including street names and the names of buildings. But reality is predicted to become more immersive into the digital space, as well as available on demand and hands-free. The fourth dark technology is quantum computing. Using quantum computers is still a tricky endeavor, but scientists are anticipating that by using quantum computers, They'll be able to create new drugs and materials and solve intractable problems, problems that can't be resolved with the limited functionality of our traditional computers. Tech companies are becoming the curators of reality by shaping how governments, businesses, employees, and individuals interact with the world through technology. Machine learning and AI already determine in no small way what news we read, what shows we watch, who we talk to, and how. Imagine movies in the future. Audiences will live inside the stories, fully immersed in fictional worlds through virtual reality. Human-like artificial intelligence characters will respond, anticipate, and react to each audience member's choices, and payments and access will be facilitated seamlessly by distributed ledger technology. By providing more digitized, customized, in-the-moment experiences, the dark technologies will increasingly monetize online life, experiences, activities, and events. What is blockchain? And is this technology going to stay or is it hype? Why has blockchain been referred to as one element of the fourth industrial revolution? In very simplistic terms, it's a global public ledger capable of automatically recording and verifying a high volume of digital transactions, regardless of location. Here's an example of an accounting ledger that documents some of the elements that the blockchain or distributed ledger captures and stores. But the blockchain is so much more. This technology will reimagine fundamental business processes and invent new styles of secure digital interactions that'll change the way the world works. Here's the process for processing a transaction on the blockchain. You hired a contractor to build another bedroom under your house. You go into the blockchain and complete a contract template for hiring a specific contractor and list all of the work you want done in the contract. That is known here as a transaction. The transaction is then sent or broadcast to a group of computers described as a peer-to-peer network. Each computer is described as a node. The network of nodes confirm that you have the money you claim to have in the transaction to pay the contractor, and the network confirms that the contractor can be trusted to complete the work according to the contractual transaction. Once all of this information is verified, it's combined with other transactions to create a block of data. The block is then added to other blocks and they become chained together with a unique identification code and timestamps. Keep in mind that all of these blocks are on a network of nodes. In other words, each block is copied onto several computers. Once all of the prior steps are complete, your transaction is also complete. A hacker can certainly hack one transaction within a block, but for the hack to be successful, it has to hack through all prior blocks in the chain and hack all nodes. Hacking has occurred, but it is very, very difficult. The tiny country of Estonia uses the blockchain for all of its governmental, societal, and economic transactions, from voting to driver's licenses, as well as for all of its healthcare, including all of its health records. Estonia uses the blockchain for its finances and banking. This little country has found that the distributed ledger has reduced some things and increased others. It's reduced costs while simultaneously increasing trust. One example of the blockchain democratizing currency transactions is remittances. This is the transfer of money by an individual residing in a foreign country to his or her home country. It's a massive global industry with annual remittances at $440 billion annually. And in 2014, it was up to an estimated $583 billion according to the World Bank. This industry is dominated by just a few players, including Western Union, MoneyGram, and Ria, who combined operate 1.1 million retail locations, and they charge more than 7% on the transfer of funds. Keep in mind that these companies only take cash, so they aren't bearing any risk of being defrauded, which is usually the justification for charging such a high percentage rate on a financial transaction. FDI, or foreign direct investment, is companies from the US, for example, opening a business in a foreign country or investing in a company headquartered in a foreign country. FDI is the largest source of foreign investment for developing countries, but this source is falling dramatically. The next biggest source of money for developing countries is remittances. And as people migrate around the globe for employment opportunities, particularly from poorer countries and into developed and developing countries like Indonesia, remittances will increase. Digital players using blockchain are just beginning to disrupt this industry. Remittances, delivered through channels outside of the major companies, are credited with reducing poverty and acting as insurance for the poor in developing countries. The blockchain has the potential to disrupt any industry that mediates the flow of money and information. In other words, the blockchain can eliminate the intermediaries or gatekeepers. The finance industry could be completely disrupted as organizations and individuals choose to exchange stocks directly with each other, and as organizations choose to trade shares of their companies on the blockchain rather than in traditional stock markets, and raise cryptocurrency in an initial coin offering or ICO rather than an initial public offering or IPO on the stock market. I already mentioned the disruption the distributed ledger could have on the remittance industry in the prior slide. In the music industry, people will be able to purchase music directly from the artist without going through iTunes. Also, any industry that relies on negotiating contracts like the real estate and legal industries could be decimated. Governments would be affected as votes are treated as securely through blockchain as online financial transactions are treated. Governments and voters would have a verifiable audit trail ensuring no votes are changed or removed and no illegitimate votes are added. One blockchain voting startup, Follow My Vote, has released the alpha version of its stake-weighted end-to-end blockchain voting solution. Estonia's voting process is managed entirely via the blockchain. Other industries potentially disrupted by the blockchain are credit cards, real estate, insurance, healthcare, legal, music, art, ride-sharing, higher education, and entire supply chain. IoT stands for Internet of Things. The Internet of Things consists of a range of smart and connected sensors that gather and communicate data to other sensors or to individuals across the internet for a wide variety of uses. If you have a smartphone and use it to help guide you from one location to another, then you're already familiar with this process. Smart sensors communicate through the cloud and create rich data. Rich data plus analytics make a decision, and then a human or a machine takes action based on that decision. Your cell phone has an IoT sensor in it and communicates to GPS satellites, which communicate to servers in the cloud, which uses AI analytics to analyze the rich data and then determine the optimal route you should take. The cloud communicates back to the satellite and then gives you directions to your destination through your phone in a time frame that can seem instantaneous. And then we do what AI tells us to do by taking the route it suggests for us. Another example of the ubiquity of the IoT, rich data, and AI is in the way ATM machine maintenance is done. Previously, mechanics followed a simple schedule. Each machine was visited weekly or on a monthly schedule, depending on the age and usage rate of the machine. However, with IoT, the machines themselves tell the maintenance crew when they need servicing. Also, the sensors inside the machines determine how quickly parts are wearing out, and based on several factors, these parts can then inform the mechanic that they need to be replaced. The IoT will enhance human and machine interaction, and creating the machine-to-machine data economy, which will grow larger than that of the human-to-human economy. Delivering value using the IoT is possible due to the ability to collect and store rich data in the cloud, and then apply smart AI analytics to determine how, when, and why people take actions or how machines are performing. This capability will reshape what we know and prioritize how we make decisions. In 1992, there were 1 million connected devices and only one type of device, computers. 20 years later, in 2012, there were nearly 9 billion devices, and the types of connected devices varied from radio frequency ID or RFID on food packaging to smartwatches to refrigerators. In 2018, there were over 42 billion connected devices, including the increasingly popular front door monitoring devices. What's important about this graph is not the specifics about the number or types of connected devices. It's the shape of the curve that's most insightful. Over long periods, technology tends toward this hockey stick shape. There's the short horizontal line connected to a sharp and ultimately a much longer vertical line, leading to increasing connectivity and complexity. In the next decade, 80 billion connected devices around the world will be in constant communication with people and with each other. This vast web of interaction, analysis, and output will remold the way objects are produced, anticipate our needs, and provide new perspectives on the world. Thanks to the ubiquity of sensors, the pool economy will be based on continuously anticipating our needs by analyzing our patterns of behavior through this device-device interaction from the IoT and the cloud and AI. The process is highly dependent on and begins with the tiny, unassuming RFID or radio frequency ID tags. The IoT is used by every industry and allows a product to be tracked throughout the entire supply chain, from producers like farmers, who then transport their goods through transportation companies, which then sends the goods to distribution centers. Next, they go to retailers. And through all of these processes, RFID information is sent to satellites and cell phone towers, which then sends the information to the cloud. You all know, of course, that the information doesn't just travel in one direction. It also goes from the cloud to other devices that people can then use to make decisions. The IoT supply chain and shipping processes are increasingly involved throughout the order fulfillment process to reduce delays and eliminate inefficiencies. In the IoT supply chain, the system can reroute truck drivers due to inclement weather or vehicle accidents closing roads. Additionally, the IoT can be used to control automated delivery of products via unmanned aerial vehicles or UAVs, which is happening to a very limited extent but could expand significantly in the future. The IoT is helping track water levels in developing nations to help with determining when to plant and harvest. It's also being used to track weather patterns, soil conditions, crop growth, and pests. It's not just being used for crops, but for livestock health as well, capturing the cow's weight, when she was last pregnant, what shots she's had, and her age, among other things. Farmers are increasingly using IoT to track crops and livestock from planting or birth to table. According to Klaus Schwab, the founder and executive chairman of the World Economic Forum, the Internet of Robotic Things, or IORT, where intelligent devices can monitor events, fuse sensor data from a variety of sources, use local and distributed intelligence to determine a best course of action, will then act to control or manipulate objects in the physical world, and in some cases, while physically moving through that world, since there will be many ways in which IoT technologies and robotic devices intersect to provide advanced robotic capabilities, new business, and investment opportunities. This sensor to satellite to tower to cloud to a device for a decision is exploding with the growing number of sensors installed in cities. These sensors are increasingly helping manage cities or create smart cities By managing energy use, providing security with more monitoring and tracking of public spaces, and via satellite coverage of rural areas, crime is predicted to decrease substantively. Cities around the world are likely to spend up to $41 trillion in smart city technology. Additionally, the IoT is enabling medical technologies to be used in remote areas through satellite coverage. You can't have smart cities without also having smart buildings. Smart buildings, which refers to both commercial buildings and homes, have sensors that track and manage food, water, energy, and waste. They also are used for security for monitoring who is where, as well as who gets access and who doesn't. IoT devices are increasingly being embedded in our clothes and our wearable devices, like the watch and the shirt pictured here. These wearables can monitor our health, including our blood pressure, skin temperature, activity levels, blood oxygen levels, heart rate, breathing rate, and sleeping patterns. In addition to using IoT and wearables to monitor our health, the tiny IoT devices are being inserted into capsules, small enough for us to ingest. Once swallowed, the ingested IoT capsule can monitor the quality of our stomachs and intestines. Additionally, implants are being used to improve health, including brain implants, to reduce the shaking that's a symptom of Parkinson's disease. Governments can use the IoT for monitoring health and harvesting, particularly for waterways like oceans, lakes, and rivers, for forestry and air quality. They can monitor infrastructure. Sensors could be embedded in the cement to make a bridge, and if the bridge becomes icy or compromised, the IoT could send a signal to a government agency to indicate the dangerous nature of the bridge and broadcast the problem to the police station so that they could cordon off the bridge, put up barriers, or schedule a repair. The IoT could also send a signal about the dangerous conditions to a smart car driving up to use the bridge and then reroute the car to a safer path. It could be used to gather more economic data than just gross domestic product, to measure the full vitality and health of society. This wealth of data could, of course, be used by governments for nefarious purposes, so having an informed and involved citizenry who also get data from the IoT and AI can ensure politicians with authoritarian tendencies aren't able to harm society. Some limitations, problems, and concerns with IoT are, of course, individual privacy. There are bandwidth limits with billions of IoT signals flying through the air. There has to be enough bandwidth for those signals to travel along. Think of bandwidth as digital highways. We don't have enough highways or lanes to accommodate the anticipated increase in data traffic. Also, 5G coverage health effects haven't sufficiently been studied because the technology is so new and hasn't been fully rolled out. Security, as we know, is a problem. The only benefit here is that there would be so much data, it would be difficult for hackers to isolate the information they want. That would only slow them down, though, not stop them completely. Device obsolescence is a major barrier. Who will track the billions of IoT devices and then replace them? Will you throw out your toaster when the IoT device in it wears out? IoTs are so cheap, the manufacturer will not pay to replace it. Will consumers demand that we be able to replace the devices rather than buy a new product? Consider the problem we already have with simply replacing cell phone batteries. Data storage on the cloud already consumes an enormous amount of energy, so data storage will continue to be a problem. There are several other issues that have to be resolved, but I expect companies will continue to embed IoT devices without attempting to solve these problems. This is a photo of the outside of a data center. You can get a perspective on the size of this by seeing how small the cars are relative to the building. They're tiny. They're down here. And here's the inside of a data center. These are also known as server farms. There are rows and rows of stacks and stacks of computer processors. And people mine the data in these data centers and harvest it. Data centers in the U.S. currently use 2% of all U.S. electricity. That's 70 billion kilowatts, which is equivalent to all of the energy used for the entire country of Austria. which has a population of more than 9 million people. AI, or artificial intelligence, is being rebranded as augmented intelligence. This term sounds less intimidating and nefarious, I suppose. Before we talk any more about AI, let's differentiate between AI and robotics. Robotics began as a replacement for laborers to save costs and improve quality, such as these robots in this auto manufacturing plant. They've become much more sophisticated, like this delivery ostrich that was created by Agility Robotics, and even more sophisticated, like this robot that can do backflips. They're stronger than humans and accomplish physical tasks that humans can't do, and they may accomplish these tasks differently, like this additive manufacturing printer building a house. Robots are being used to milk cows and harvest food, taking over other tasks humans are uninterested in doing or are hard on human bodies. Our physical world may change to accommodate robots as they take over more physically demanding tasks from humans. AI is different than robotics. Although robotics can be run with AI, they are not the same thing. You can think of robotics as the body and AI as the brain. Unlike humans, you can separate AI or the brain from robotics or the body. The information presented on this slide and the next slide is from the work of Brian Rees in his book, The Fourth Age: Smart Robots, Conscious Computers, and the Future of Humanity. Rees defines two high-level categories of AI, including narrow AI and artificial general intelligence, or AGI. Narrow AI is defined as the ability for a computer to solve a specific problem or perform a specific task, and it includes the three approaches of classic AI, expert systems, and machine learning. And then there are several variations on these three approaches. The term classic was included in the name for the first approach because in the earliest days of AI research, this was the approach computer scientists used to build an AI. This approach involved creating a model that assesses factors such as climate conditions, pests, and soil type to then determine what type of crops should be planted and when. So it's based on data and modeling. In the second approach, a system is created by taking hundreds of farmers and getting them to write down every rule they know about planting. The rules are then arranged in a way that someone can enter their relevant variables and the system will make a suggestion based on those rules. This approach is described as the expert system. The third and most recent approach is machine learning. This approach refers to the process of taking all of the rich data concerning when everyone planted and what the yields were, and you get a computer to build rules that, in retrospect, would have maximized those yields. The difficulty with machine learning lies in human ability to decipher the output in the machine. The machine may recommend planting corn on May 12th, for example. But when asked why, it may be difficult to tease out an answer if there are many factors at work. An example of narrow AI in business is the use of chatbots. Chatbots are defined as a software application used to conduct an online chat conversation via text or text-to-speech in lieu of providing direct contact with a live human. Chatbots have gotten quite sophisticated, and businesses are using it to answer customer questions. When the bot can't answer a question from a customer, the call then gets routed to a human, and the human answers the question. The human then updates the bot so that the bot can accurately answer more and more questions, increasingly reducing reliance on human customer service agents, and of course, reducing human customer service employment. I encourage you to listen to this Google Duplex recording. The chatbot sounds remarkably human and uses human pauses and ums. In fact, it sounds so realistic that people have expressed concern about being fooled by it and have requested that Google make it clear when people are talking to its chatbot. AI companies are hoping that their chatbots will become the digital spokesperson for firms. Some industry changes are predictive equipment maintenance, logistics optimization, or moving things faster, but also making fewer trips by loading fewer semi-trucks so that they're full, yet make fewer stops at destination centers. And of course, autonomous vehicles. Financial systems will use the IoT to monitor accounts for fraud. And they've quietly replaced human financial traders with AI. Goldman Sachs had 600 traders in 2000. By 2017, they were down to two. That was 3 years ago. The New York Stock Exchange prepares backup plans to operate without human traders. This is what the floor of the New York Stock Exchange looked like during business hours in the 1930s. And this is what it looked like last year. Many, many fewer traders on the floor. General AI, unlike narrow or weak AI, is also described as artificial general intelligence or strong AI. There is no common definition for determining when AGI has been achieved, so hopefully we'll know it when we see it. But basically, it's defined as occurring when a machine is able to solve problems it hasn't been trained to solve, or when a machine can perform any task as well or better than a human can. This is described as passing the Turing test. How close are we to achieving AGI? Capability-wise, we're still quite far from achieving artificial general intelligence. However, as you saw in the hockey stick graph for the Internet of Things, technologies that seem decades away from becoming reality can quickly become commonplace. A survey of AI experts recently predicted that the expected emergence of AI, or somewhat futurists are describing as the singularity, will occur around 2060, which puts it beyond my lifetime. Combined, robotics and AI are driving toward the availability of a continuum of autonomous vehicles. There are vehicles that humans run entirely. Then there are vehicles that are run via autopilot with human assistance. Most commercial aircraft are run this way using the flight management system. Some airlines require that autopilot lands and flies the aircraft when it gets over 3,000 feet. There are also remotely run vehicles, such as military and private drones, but Australia has a fleet of remotely controlled semi-trucks that carry cargo from mines in remote areas to other transit areas. And finally, there are a few fully autonomous vehicles run by a combination of AI and robotics. There are just a few slides on the cloud and quantum computing. The cloud allows software and services to run on the internet instead of locally on your computer. I'm sure most of you are aware of this difference. The advantage of the cloud is that you can access your information from any device with an internet connection. There are three different types of cloud services. There is a public cloud, which shares resources and offers services to the public over the internet. A private cloud, which doesn't share data publicly, but offers services over a private internal network. This is typically hosted on premises. And there's a hybrid cloud. This shares services between public and private clouds. Problems include security due to hackers, privacy, nuisance advertising, fees, connectivity, and equal access. Data is sent to the cloud from a variety of sources, like all of the IoT sensors I mentioned previously and computers. We share all kinds of information about ourselves with the cloud. The sensors in our watches, phones, and cars send our location information to the cloud. There are 2.4 billion Facebook users who share an incredible amount of personal data with the cloud. Data is then analyzed and used for a variety of reasons. Generally, businesses use the data we send to the cloud to analyze our behavior, to determine what products and services to offer, to whom, and how. Netflix uses viewer information to improve the movie recommendations it makes for us. Amazon makes it easy for us to find any items we want to purchase, and it builds trust by providing user reviews. This is IBM's quantum computer. A traditional computer uses bits, one position, a one or a zero, and this is sufficient for most computing uses. A quantum computer uses quantum bits, or qubits. There is a superposition for a quantum computer. There is a one or a zero, or there are both a one and a zero. This gives a quantum computer the potential to process exponentially more data than classical computers. It can perform 1 billion or more copies of a computation at the same time. In a way, this is similar to a parallel computer with 1 billion processors performing different computations at the same time. The dark technologies are only a few of the disruptive technologies that are somewhere on this hockey stick curve. Additive printing. You probably have heard about this form of printing as 3D or 4D printing. It's been around for more than 30 years and capable of manufacturing a wide variety of products. You can print toys and tools such as wrenches and food. You can print clothes, although the clothes tend to be inflexible and uncomfortable. A company is building a housing community in Central America. Each house will cost about $6,000. They have one bedroom, a kitchen, a living room, and a front porch and a bathroom. You can print transportation. Here's a photo of an additive printed car. You can print mechanical parts. Ships have additive printers on board so they can print a tool or part while at sea, and they don't have to divert and delay their journey to go to a port for repairs. You can print prosthetics. Musical instruments, guns, drones, storage containers to store anything, anything big or small. You can print dishes and furniture. You can even print human organs. Surgeons print human organs to practice on before conducting surgery on the person. It's anticipated that eventually individuals will own smaller printers, just like we have paper printers in our homes. And communities will have larger printers for community projects. Neurotechnology to enhance cognition and resolve mental health problems that are preventing people from fully participating in society the way they'd like is another technology in the fourth industrial revolution. Parkinson's disease is one area of focus. Also in this illustration, the man is using his mind to tell his robotic hand what to do. The hand is so sensitive that the man can pick up a grape without squashing it. This gentleman can accurately be described as a cyborg. Robots, such as exoskeletons, can help some people walk who have had spinal cord injuries. Exoskeletons are also being used by healthy people to enhance their current physical capabilities, for example, to run faster or carry heavier loads without injury. Warehouse owners are particularly interested in the heavier load carrying capability. And you can imagine the uses the military might have for this technology. Nanotechnology is another technology in the fourth industrial revolution. This type of technology is focused on the very small, like this tiny bug drone, and technology that can fit in a pill to assess the health of our internal systems and organs, as I described previously. Energy technology research, as you probably guessed, is working to improve the quality and reduce the costs of renewable energy sources, including wind, solar, tidal, geothermal, and the more controversial alternative energy sources of biomass, nuclear, and hydro. Another emerging technology is advanced materials. In this photo is a structure, and you can see how big it is as you compare it to the cars that you can see through the arch. It's quite large, and the metal is made of carbon nanotubes, and I've blown up a picture of a carbon nanotube here for you to see. But the metal breathes like skin. As you can see, I hope, little pieces of the metal are sticking up. When the sun shines on the structure, these pieces lift up or open, letting the breeze flow through. When it's darker, the pieces lie flat to keep the interior warmer. There are also frequently new findings from biotech research investigating how to improve our health, such as CRISPR. This is the technique that allows scientists to cut out a piece of our DNA and replace it with a different piece of DNA. This technology has the potential to radically improve human health, both on an individual basis and as a species, by modifying the reproductive elements of our genetic code. And finally on this list is virtual or augmented reality. In the example shown, VR can be used to help people envision how furniture and accessories, as well as paint colors, will look in their homes. Also, haptic devices are being perfected at Penn State. These devices allow wearers to experience the sense of touch. One of the uses for this device is to allow shoppers to feel the products they want to buy. So if you want to buy a pair of leather shoes from an Italian cobbler, you could put on your haptic gloves and your VR headset and pick up the shoes and feel the leather virtually before purchasing them. In the movie Ready Player One, the main character used a haptic device to experience the physical sensations of the virtual reality video game he played. There are higher education impacts because of these disruptive technologies. And education on these technologies is not just for computer nerds or IT students. A variety of the technologies identified in this presentation will be embedded in every profession, from engineering to art and music, from healthcare to welding, mechanics, construction, business manager and human resources, agriculture, animal husbandry, environmental science, textiles, and restaurants. Students in every program should be learning about some of these technologies and how they can benefit from them occupationally and personally. So, should we prepare for the coming of the robots? No, not yet. However, robots are stronger than humans and have been increasingly adopted in manufacturing to improve product quality and reduce costs. Robots don't take breaks for food. They don't sleep. They don't take parental leave. They don't get sick like humans. And the entire fleet of robots can be trained simultaneously with a single software update. The goal of manufacturing and warehouse managers is to have only robots in their facilities in what's referred to as a lights-out facility. This means that there are no humans in the factory, so it can be run 24/7 with the lights out. With the massive amount of data from IoT and other sources being sent to the cloud, and with AI to analyze the rich data, the IT ecosystem is becoming more knowledgeable than humans. It's simply humanly impossible to collect and store and analyze the information that's in the IT ecosystem. With robots taking over blue and white collar jobs, manufacturing and knowledge work, what jobs will humans have? It'll be a while before these technologies are adopted universally. For some regions, it'll take many decades, and some companies will never adopt all of these technologies and will continue to have a majority human workforce. Also, even when these technologies are more ubiquitous, machines don't have yet the ability to do physically nimble work, such as carefully moving a patient. Humans will continue to be in care occupations such as nursing, teaching, and counseling. Also, humans are needed for ethical and creative problem solving. There's still a place for us in society and the economy. I wish I could be with you in person to respond to questions, but feel free to contact me at rraleigh@penncole.edu. My email address is here in the left-hand corner. If you'd like to chat more about any of the topics I've presented, I am by no means a content expert on any of this, definitely a novice, but I'm always eager to learn more and to share more and collaborate. So feel free to contact me. I hope you have a terrific rest of your time at the conference and that you've learned something from this presentation.